1995. The survivor is Leo Schenker. The interviewer, Sherry Mattenstein. We're in New York City, USA, and the language is English. June 1st, 1995. The survivor is Leo Schenker. I am Sherry Mattenstein. We're in New York City in the USA, and we are speaking today in English. Could you tell me your name and spell it for me?
My name is Leo Schenker, S-C-H-E-N-K-E-R.
And were you known by any nicknames at all?
I was known in Vienna also under the name of Leo Gottesmann, because the family name was Schenker Gottesmann.
Could you spell that, please?
G-O-T-T-E-S-M-A-N.
Okay, and your birth date?
I was born November 24th, 1921.
And how old are you right now?
73 and a half.
And again, where were you born?
In Vienna, Austria.
And that's where you grew up?
That is correct.
Okay. Could you talk a bit about your family and your home life?
My family was a middle class family. We were three brothers, two brothers and myself, father and mother. We went to high school in Vienna, first to lower class school and then to high school. All to the same school. We lived a typical bourgeois life, went away for vacation, had no great problems except passing the exams in school as kids. Most of our time was spent sports, being with other kids. It was a carefree and very pleasant existence.
What kind of sports did you do?
I played soccer. I played also what in Austria they called handball, which is like soccer but played with the hand. We played table tennis, we were quite good at, and bicycling.
What kind of work does your family do?
My father was a partner in a scythe factory. Scythes are not being used in the United States very much, but in Europe they're being used for cutting grass or grain. And many countries like Czechoslovakia, Poland, Russia bought scythes to cut their various crops. Austria was one of the countries which exported large quantities of scythes.
Did you ever go into work with your father? Were you interested in what he did?
No. My father's work, to a very large extent, was not in Vienna. In Vienna, we had just a very small office together with his brother. The factory was outside of Vienna, near Mariazell. It's about an hour and a half drive at that time. Today it's probably 45 minutes. The scythes were sold in Poland. My father spent most of his time in the office in Poland or in the factory.
How large was Vienna?
Vienna was a population of 2 million people, still today more or less the same.
What was the Jewish population?
About 200,000.
Did you experience anti-Semitism when you were growing up?
I was not aware of any anti-Semitism. Some people talked about it, but in school about 75% or 80% of the children were Jewish, and most of my friends were Jewish. We had one or two non-Jewish friends, but I personally did not experience any anti-Semitism, although my parents probably did.
How observant was your family?
We were traditional. We observed the holy days like Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Passover. went those days to synagogue. Otherwise, we were not very observant.
Did you observe any rituals in the home? Passover, maybe?
Passover, yes. We observed the rituals. It means no bread, matzah, and we had the Seder. Either at our home or somebody else's home.
Was it fun for you? Did you enjoy the Seder?
Yes, I did, because we always, as kids, were looking for the Afikoimen, and we were looking forward to be rewarded when we found it, and we sure blackmailed our uncles or fathers to give us what we wanted.
What are your happiest memories as a child?
A carefree, warm, loving existence. A good mother, a good father, a good family life.
How many languages did you speak? Did you learn?
When I was in Vienna, I spoke one language, German, and in high school, I learned French.
What sort of work did you want to do?
I really had not decided at that time. I think I was too young to think about what to do when I grew up.
When do you think you were first aware of hearing Hitler or Nazis?
Well, after 1933, when Hitler came into power in Germany, obviously it was a daily conversation. Newspapers wrote about what was happening in Germany, not necessarily in connection with Jews, but in connection with politics. And as kids, we read those articles, or some of those articles, and we became aware of some of the things which were happening in Germany, although we didn't realize what was happening.
Do you think that your parents were worried at all, or thought?
No, not at all.
So how was the rise of Nazism perceived in your family once the anti-Jewish nature?
In Austria, we did not feel any Nazism because basically the country was run by a Christian Socialist or Christian Democratic Party, Schuschnigg and Dollfuss. We had some problems, some revolutions, but it was not felt by us, although the party might have been anti-Semitic, and sure it was anti-Semitic, but that didn't affect us, and we just did not think in terms of fear or leaving Austria. We felt very secure.
What about when the Anschluss happened, when the Germans moved in?
Well, then the whole thing changed. My father at that time was in Poland on business. We stayed for several months until we finished school. The Anschluss was March 13th, 1938, and we left early June for Poland.
What do you remember of when it occurred in March?
I remember the fear which suddenly became part of our daily life. I remember beating of Jews. I remember that Jews were forced to clean the streets with toothbrushes. I remember that people were taken to the Gestapo headquarters and never came back. It was a sudden change in life, which is difficult to describe, because from great security we suddenly came into a life of insecurity and fear.
How did you feel?
What do you mean, how I felt? I didn't feel very happy. We were just trying to finish the school and leave. So by June, we finished and we left.
And then what happened?
We went to Silesia, a little village was called Jejitz, next to Katowice or Bielsko. And we lived relatively well because we had their warehouses of scythe, and we had enough money to live comfortable. It was a time which was difficult for us because we did not speak the foreign language, Polish, and we thought we wasted a whole year, but we actually did not waste it because I read every week two or three books. I learned English and I learned bridge, and those were the occupations of my days.
Was it hard to leave home to go to Poland?
No, just the country. We felt extremely happy because we felt blessed that we could leave Austria, we could leave the insecurity, the fear, the beatings, the threats which were a daily occurrence. Poland life was normal. After a few weeks, we had a completely normal life.
And did it remain normal until the outbreak of the war, or when did things start?
Well, it was normal until about two or three weeks before the outbreak of the war. As I said, we were in Silesia, which was on the German border. My father and mother felt insecure in Silesia, and in order to be more secure, we moved to Krakow, which is a few hours' drive from Silesia. And there we experienced the beginning of the war. I remember as of today that on September 1st at about 4:30 in the morning, we saw airplanes shooting and flying very low over our roof. And we thought that the Polish army was doing some exercises. And we were very surprised when at about 6 o'clock the radio announced that the Germans had invaded Poland. We stayed a few days in Poland, then we had a car. I had a driver's license, had never driven very much, and we all piled into a small car and drove eastwards. And we drove from September 4th to about September 15th. We drove is not quite correct. We traveled first by car, then we couldn't get gasoline. We bought a carriage and a horse, and then finally we were as far east as the Russians, as the Russian army occupied Poland, and we suddenly found ourselves with the Russians, and we continued our voyage for another few hours to Lviv, which is one of the largest cities in Polish Ukraine.
Who were you with?
My parents and my two brothers.
And what do you remember seeing as the journey progressed?
I remember terrible things on the journey were attacks by planes, the German army with the low-flying Stukas attacked soldiers, civilian population. You could see machine guns just decimating people. I thought at that time that this is probably the most cruel experience I'll have in my life, and I never will forget it. I was wrong, and today I have forgotten it. Don't know, because I saw other things which were worse, or because time is a great healer.
What happened then, once you got to law?
Well, we went to school in Lvov, and we, my father, got some work. I think he worked in Romanian, some Romanian delegation because he spoke some Romanian. We went to school. We led a relatively normal life. It was not the most pleasant life, but it was all right under the Russians until June 1941, when the Russian-German war started.
Before that, though, how large an apartment did all of you have? How was getting food?
We started with a large apartment because we were able to get into a large apartment. Once the Russians made themselves comfortable in Lvov, they left us only with one, two, three rooms, and they took the other three rooms. But it was comfortable enough to live without difficulties. The only problem was to share a kitchen or a bathroom with a strange couple, a Russian officer and his wife. But it was not the worst thing in the world. One could live, and one did live comfortably. We had enough to eat. We went to school and learned, and we got to learn a lot about communism, because Lvov was managed by Communist Party, Communist government, and it was quite an experience to observe the tremendous change between the capitalistic and the communistic world.
What were some of the differences that you noticed?
The differences were that nobody really worked hard, because you were paid anyway, whether you worked hard or didn't work. There was always a shortage of goods. Most people stole from their place of work, whether it was pencils or bread or stockings, and exchanged it for things they did not have. It was a system which killed individualism, which didn't reward enterprise, which did not want individuality. All what they wanted is to have wheels within wheels to turn with the bigger wheels. Obviously, there was a lot of corruption, because you could buy anything with goods. Buy maybe isn't the word, maybe the correct word is get anything. I think the system got back to the 14th or 15th century, where money wasn't used, but merchandise was traded. And this, to a very large extent, was part of communism. To get what you need by giving other things which you had in surplus. The good thing in the communist system was the schooling. As students, we were considered privileged people. We got monthly salaries for going to school. We, as students, had privileges which you don't have in other societies. But I think that's the only very good thing I can say about life under communism.
What did you know of what was happening elsewhere in Poland or back home?
No, it was very difficult to get information. We could listen to German radio, but the German radio gave us information which were not always correct. The only news which we always listened to was BBC. Every evening BBC had information in German, and we listened to the news of BBC religiously every night.
And then what happened?
Then life changed again. The Germans came into Lviv, and from the first moment on...
Do you remember when they came in, exactly?
If I'm not mistaken, it was June 21st, 1941, June 23rd. It was the second half of June. It took them exactly 1 hour, and the Ukrainians who lived in Lviv joined forces with the Germans and started a program. Hundreds of Jews were killed in the first day. Extremely cruel, without any discrimination. If they caught a Jew, he was beaten or killed. After 2 days, this stopped, and life became more normal. When they say normal, the Germans started a policy of slow degradation of the Jews. It is like every day a little bit more was taken away. There was beating on the streets, and after a month or even earlier, people were taken from the street to work in certain areas. In the beginning, it was work. Later on, they were taken to camps. There was one very famous or infamous camp on Janowska Street, which was beyond description. People were killed, people were dehumanized, people were starved, people were made more animals, they were more animals than human beings, and this was the beginning of the destruction of the Jews in Lviv. After a few months, the Germans decided that Jews were moving into a certain area of the city, which was a ghetto. The ghetto was bigger in the beginning. Every few weeks it was made smaller. I remember when we moved into the ghetto, we had one room and one kitchen for five of us, which wasn't so bad. Within a short time, we had to take on some more people to be able to live there. The moving to the ghetto was no picnic. We had some of our property on a carriage, which we pushed ourselves. There were Ukrainians and Poles on the way to the ghetto who laughed at us, insulted us, sometimes beat us. When you came to the door of the ghetto, the gate of the ghetto, there was German police and SS, and they added to the degradation by either beating or taking things away. One was delighted to have passed all these obstacles to get into the ghetto and be able to settle down.
How much of your belongings were you able to take with you to the
whatever
ghetto?
You could carry, or whatever you could push on a little carriage.
Were there any particular instances that you recall, maybe even before the ghetto was formed, of cruelty that you saw to the Jews? Perhaps anything happened to yourself?
No, nothing happened to myself, except what I observed. I was taken to this camp on Janowska Street, and I saw what was happening there. And after 2 days, I was sent to another camp, which was about 10 miles from Lvov. It was called Vinnytsky. And there, a number of Jews, were not too many, there were, I would say, about 30 or 35, worked on a large farm which belonged to the Gestapo. And we were basically growing fruits or cutting grass. Basically, it was farm work. And we had only one SS man who supervised us and a number of Polish workers with whom we worked. It was not pleasant, but compared to what I had seen on Janowska, it was paradise.
What had you seen there?
Well, I saw the people being beaten up, people being shot in front of others, tremendous demonization that if an Ukrainian policeman, who by the way were possibly even worse than the Germans, asked you to lick the boots, he would lick the boots because he were afraid. You people in the camp did anything in order not to be beaten, in order not to suffer more than they did. Everybody hoped that somehow they're going to survive. This was not an extermination camp as you know it under Auschwitz or Belzec or Treblinka. This was a working camp where people were tortured with work and with beating and with shooting.
And then you said the camp that you were then at, Winnicky, was much easier
the
in comparison.
The camp I was in was a paradise compared to Janowska. I don't think I would call it today a paradise, but at that time we worked hard. We had enough food we could steal food. When we picked tomatoes, we ate as many tomatoes as we could. When we picked apples, we ate as many apples as we could. When there were potatoes, which we sometimes stole and ate, we were not hungry in this in this camp, whereas in Janowska people were terribly hungry because they just didn't get enough food. For some people, the time at this camp was terrible because they were in the camp and they learned that their wives or children or brother or parents were taken away or killed. And we had two or three people who committed suicide. We also delivered fruit and vegetable to the Gestapo headquarters in Lvov, and usually there was an SS driver in the lorry, and there were usually two or three of us on the outside who loaded and unloaded the fruit or vegetables, and we saw then when we unloaded them in the Gestapo headquarters what was going on with some of the prisoners there, and the torture and dehumanization and the way prisoners were treated. Very difficult to imagine that a thing like that exists. I think I don't have to go into it because I think you know, or everybody knows, what the Gestapo was able to do with human beings.
Tape number two, today is June 1st, 1995. Survivor, Leo Schenker, interviewer, Sherry Mattenstein.
So we were talking about you were with Nikki and you were saying it was much less brutal.
That's correct. the things which we saw happened in the Gestapo headquarters or in some small villages which were visited from time to time by us to bring in some fruit or something else or some geese for the Gestapo headquarters. As I mentioned before, one of the things which the Gestapo accomplished was to dehumanize a human being, that the human being was willing to do anything the SS man asked him to do. It is possibly difficult to understand this, but with beating, with torture, with hunger, you can get people to obey the same as a dog obeys. And it is a terrible, degrading thing to see this happen to 1, 2, 5, 20 people. It's a terrible thing as an outsider to see what one man, a group of men, can do to others. I think that many of the people were not even aware what has happened to them and how deep they had sunk. They wanted only one thing, not to be killed. They were willing to do anything to survive. And I think this happened also in other camps. The survival instinct is much stronger than most people know or realize. And the Germans somehow, either through science or through practice, learned very fast what they can do with human beings, and they did it.
What sorts of, when you say that people would do anything to survive, what do you mean? What sorts of things did you see people doing?
Steal food and risk, because they were hungry. Steal food from others. Inform on people. The stronger beating weakers, and I'm not talking only about Jews, there were also Poles or Ukrainians in the Gestapo prison. It was terrible to see what people, what prisoners were willing to do to each other to survive.
Who were you in the camp with?
I was with my older brother and with some people, got to know mostly, they came from Lvov, and we considered ourselves lucky to live there and to be able to survive there. We consider ourselves unlucky as far as our families are concerned, because many of the people who worked in this camp lost their loved ones over a period of time. We were able to visit home every 2 or 3 weeks. We walked home for Saturday or Sunday. And we came back, and the SS was so sure of us that we would come back that we were told only if somebody doesn't come back, all the 35 people would be killed. We were sure they would do it, so somebody went to visit his family, they always came back.
Who was left of your family at that time?
My mother and father and my younger brother were living in Lvov. My other brother and I, my older brother and I, lived in the camp. This went on until August 1942. The Germans took out continuously people from the ghetto, loaded them on trains, and shipped them to extermination camps. First, they took sick people, weak people, children, then older ones. If you didn't have a pass showing that you worked somewhere, you were taken from the street, loaded into cars, the railroad cars, and shipped to extermination camps. The ghetto was made smaller and smaller every few weeks because there were less and less people there. In August 1942, my parents were taken from the apartment we were living in and were shipped to Belzec, which was an extermination camp. My youngest brother was with my parents in the apartment, and my mother saved him by opening the door, and he was accidentally hidden behind the open door, and the SS-man just didn't look and took my parents, and my younger brother survived this way. He lives today in Houston, but I'll come back later on, tell about his experience. My middle brother, his name was Kurt, had an accident when working with wood, hurt his foot. He was sent back to Lemberg to recuperate. He never came, never had a chance to come back to the camp, because in September 1942, the camp we were in was liquidated. That means all the people were taken to an extermination camp, and many of them were killed. Two of my friends jumped from the train and came back to Lvov. I saw them, I spoke with them, and as a matter of fact, one of them later on, through similar stories I have to tell later on, survived and went to Israel, where he became a well-known lawyer, and in the meantime he died. But from them I knew that the camp was liquidated. Now, you ask me how come that you were not liquidated. Well, there was an SS man who was in charge of the camp. For one reason or the other, I was respected by him. I spoke perfectly German and we could converse.
Do you remember his name?
Nope. Every few months they changed. But this one said to me, you're going tomorrow to Lvov, you have to do this and this and this for me, and I will pick you up in 3 days. He always picked us up in a certain place, and I wasn't in 3 days. And when I got into the car, he said to me, just want you to know you were lucky. There's nobody left in the camp. And he took me back to a place where they stored straw. And I spent there 1 week. It was already October at that time, I think, because it was cold. It could have been end September or October. So I know that my feet were swollen on account of the cold. I was afraid to move during the day because Polish farmers were there. I lived from some food which was left for me by the SS men. And after a week I survived, went back to Lvov, met my brothers. We decided that there was no chance for us to survive, because we were seeing that the ghetto was becoming smaller and smaller, and more people are being transported to extermination camps.
Do you know how large the ghetto was to begin with and how it was shrinking?
No, I would not know. My younger brother decided that he would go on his own. He was young. He was at that time 42. He was born 27, 37, 14 years or 15 years old. He would go to Krakow where he had some friends. He thought they would help him. And with a little bit of money, he made his way to Krakow. I will later on tell what happened to him. My other brother, Kurt, and I decided that we are going to buy ourselves forged papers and try to leave Lwów by joining a group of workers who were recruited for work in Russia. We had a little bit of money. We gave to one of the Poles we knew the money to give us forged papers, to get us forged papers and get us on this transport. We were duped. We got the forged paper, but we never got on the transport. We never got the papers from the transport. And we found ourselves in Lwów. This was, I think, November, early December, because I remember the snow, without a possibility to go back to the ghetto, because we had, in the meantime, removed all signs that we were Jews, Mugendowitz, from our hands and so on, from our arms. And we were absolutely desperate. We decided to commit suicide. We walked in a park. We had what we thought, poison with us. And after walking for half an hour, and I remember distinctly the snow and the sunshine, we sat down on the bench and we took the poison, and we found out that it wasn't poisoned, that we, expecting to die, did not die, but just had eaten something which didn't do us any damage. And there we were, without money, without anywhere to go. We decided to go with our forged papers to one of the places which recruited workers, and without difficulties, we were taken on the transport, which was leaving the same night.
What exactly did you do to get on the transport?
The organization TAT was looking for workers. They were desperate to get workers to Russia. People didn't want to go. When we volunteered, we were received with open arms. They didn't even look at us. They didn't look at our documents, which were all right on there. And we found ourselves, without any difficulties, on this transport to Sevastopol.
What was the nationality of the other workers on the transport?
They were all Poles. And within a relatively short time, we came to the conclusion that a quarter of the Poles were Jews, also traveling with forged papers. The Poles also, within a very short time, found out that there were Jews amongst them, and they started the blackmail. We got to Sevastopol.
What sort of blackmail?
Blackmail. Money, watches, whatever they wanted, you know. People were not going to fight with them.
You've said that a Jew could sort of sense when there were other Jews?
Very, very much so. Still until today.
How do you mean that? Yeah.
I think I can look and talk to somebody and sense whether it's Jewish or not in most instances, not always, but at that time I think I could do it nearly always. Our luck was that my brothers and I did not look Jewish, just the contrary, we looked very non-Jewish, and that probably saved our lives. We did not speak perfectly Polish. The Poles did not know what to do with us. They didn't know whether we were Jewish or what kind of animals we were, and we explained to them that we were Volksdeutsche, that means Germans living in Poland, and that's why I spoke perfect German but did not speak Polish so well. And for the time being, they accepted it. When we came to Sevastopol, we spent 2 days or 3 days there, and my brother and I came to the conclusion that this is not going to last. The Poles were blackmailing and were demanding more and more from the Jews, and one of these days convinced they're going to denounce them to the Germans. So my brother and I got ourselves travel paper to a hospital. We felt sick, we wanted to go there. My brother got the travel papers, I couldn't get them, but I went with him and I was hiding behind him, and we got on the train. And
how did you hide behind him? How did you manage to go?
He got in the compartment, I went in the compartment with him to say goodbye, and instead of going out, I went into the toilet. And funny thing was that when the inspector came to look at my brother's paper, he saw the paper is fine, then he went to the next compartment. The toilet was between two compartments. I went into my brother's compartment, and when he was in the other compartment, he looked in the toilet, we could hear the doors. So it was just a question of luck. I mean, we sounds like a very faraway story, but that's what I remember from it. We got this in Faribault, and we
did you and your brother feel it was maybe some sort of sign when you tried to commit suicide and
I don't understand your question.
Well, some sort of sign that you really were meant to make it through the war because you tried.
No, we didn't believe in signs. We didn't expect to make it through the war, but we both were fighters and we thought we're going to give a good fight, try to survive, but we were not convinced that we will succeed. But you have to be an optimist, and we were optimists, and as we were together, it was much easier than being by yourself. We got to Simferopol, we went to a Wehrmacht recruiting station with our papers, and the Volksdeutsche told them we want to join a unit. The Germans were not asking any question because we were not the only ones, there were other Volksdeutsche coming from Crimea and so on. And my brother got assigned as a civilian, but part of the German army, to a radio station, and I was assigned as a civilian, but part of the German army, to a garage. This garage repaired cars for the German army. There were hundreds of workers there, and suddenly our morning greeting was Heil Hitler, and our food was food which the German army got. We didn't have German uniforms. We had, we had German pants and German shirts, but as civilians we didn't have any insignia. But we were treated like soldiers. And we had the same regulation as soldiers had. I mean, we had to go to the doctor ever so often. We got our ration every morning. We got paid. And I was in this unit from December 41. December No, December 42 to about October 43 or November 43. And in the beginning, we were very insecure of ourselves because we didn't know how to behave, what to do. But with time, we became more and more secure. I ran the office. Garage had to have an office for, you know, repair work. There were a number of French and Poles working there as mechanics under German supervision. German cars were repaired from, since anytime I wanted to have a car, I could get a car from the garage and go any place I wanted to within the city, because there were always some cars to be tried out. And as long as I was not discovered, life was not too unpleasant. What was unpleasant is the insecurity that when you saw a Gestapo car or an SS car coming in, you always thought, oh, is it for me? No, it wasn't for me, it was just to be repaired. When you saw a car from the police, from the army police coming, always you figured, is it for me? It wasn't for me, it was to be repaired. So, you know, with time you became more and more secure. Evenings, 3-4 times a week, my brother and I spent together. He worked on the radio station, and I was in this garage, and we were together until the German army started to retreat from the Crimea.
Let's just talk a little bit more about this period. How did it feel leading this sort of double life, having to say Heil Hitler?
You get accustomed to it. As I mentioned before, one does anything to survive. And if you have to say just Heil Hitler to survive, you'll say it as often as you have to. We had absolutely no contact with Jews. There were no Jews in, we didn't meet any Jews in Sinferber. I don't think there were any left. All our contacts were strictly with German soldiers or officers or with French or Polish mechanics from the garage.
How did you get along with the German soldiers?
Fabulously. We ate with them in the same canteen. We drank with them the same drinks. We had absolutely no problems. It was easier for us to be with German soldiers who never suspected that we could be Jewish than with the Polish workers in Sevastopol who always were suspicious of us. We spoke German perfectly, which was an advantage, and we survived this 7 or 8 months without any problems, without any difficulties.
Were you angry at them, at the soldiers? I mean, having to be pleasant to them?
No. I don't think we were angry. I don't think you at that time thought of anger. We were elated about our ability to survive. We had to be very careful not to become too cocky, because everything was so easy. Everything went so easy. In our German uniforms, we went to the theater. We went to movies. We could go anywhere. German soldiers could go for recreation. We were never questioned. We had our papers in order, so to say. and we were part of the German army. And this was, once you were part of it, it was a very easy way to survive.
Did they talk about Jews a lot?
Not at all. I mean, we didn't hear anything. And neither did we.
And then what happened?
Before I come to what happened, I want to just mention my younger brother who was living in Krakow, or he was vegetating in Krakow. We got an information through a friend of ours. It was sent to Lvov, the non-Jewish friend, who forwarded it to another friend. And we got it finally that my brother was in great difficulties in Krakow, that he was living in doorways, he was scrounging for food, that he had no home, the people who had hoped would help him did not help him, and that he might not be able to survive much longer. A Polish worker, I think it was a Polish worker, a German worker, I don't remember, was going back for furlough. And we falsified a travel document, which was very easy for me because I was making out travel documents for the Poles or for the French for their vacation or for their home leave. I made it out for my brother to come from Krakow to Simferopol. I gave it to this man who went on vacation to give it to a Polish friend of my brother's in Krakow, which he did. And I was sitting with my brother in his room, and suddenly a young man appeared, my brother. And it was just unbelievable the way he looked, and we were overjoyed to see him. I mean, and he says, "Don't touch me, I have lice, I'm in terrible condition." What we did is, remember, if today we had some washing basin or whatever it is, we filled it with hot water, we took all the clothing from my brother and threw it away, washed him. He was, I would say, undernourished to an extent, was unbelievable. We fed him, we kept him for 3 or 4 days in bed, and then we got him proper clothing, and one of the men, Germans, who was head of a farm unit in Jankoi, which was entrance of the Crimea, was looking for an interpreter, and we sent my brother there, and my brother spent the balance of the war in this farm, and then retreated with the German army and got to Lvov and then Vienna, and today he is in Houston. But he probably suffered more than any of us, because for about 6 or 7 months, he lived, as I said, in doorways, without any help, and survived.
Today is June 1st, 1995. Survivor Leo Schenker, interviewer Sherry Mattenstein.
You were talking about your younger brother.
Brother. Well, one of our problems during the time in the Army were medical visits. We were frightened of the doctor, for obvious reasons. In the beginning, I was sent for a checkup. I didn't know what to do.
When was this, when you were sent for a checkup?
And when I joined the unit, the checkup, the doctor's visit. I didn't know what to do, how to escape. I went to the hospital where the doctor, I was supposed to see the doctor. I was not going to go up to see him. I was thinking of fleeing Simferopol. I saw a piece of paper signed by the doctor, which I was supposed to see. I stole this piece of paper from, which was hanging on the wall, went back to my room, started to falsify the signature until I had it pretty much under control, and I signed my checkup. This was, you know, the piece of paper of the checkup. This was the first experience. Then we were sent from time to time. We could not, once I couldn't escape, I had to go for the lousing, which the German army went from time to time. That means it's a treatment against lice, and you got in the shower, I soaped myself as fast as I could, and went, got my clothing, and when I got my clothing, the man said, "You still have soap on you," in a certain place, and I thanked him very much for drawing it to my attention. I put my clothes on and left. But these were the most unpleasant and dangerous experiences I had. With time, we knew how to handle it. We just could falsify the signatures. But in the beginning, you didn't know how to handle doctor's visits, which were rather dangerous for us. Otherwise, it was a pretty carefree existence. We were just waiting for the Russians to occupy Simferopol. One day, we were called together and we were told that the whole unit is evacuating Simferopol, moving to Odessa and Tiraspol. Tiraspol was near the Romanian border. My brother was told that his unit is going to Kherson. We decided to stay with our units and not to try to stay in Simferopol because we would have been shot as deserters. I went with the unit to Odessa and to Tiraspol, and my brother went to Kherson, and I never heard from my brother again. I checked later on when the war was finished with some people who were also at the unit, and I was told that he had a nervous breakdown and probably was shot. Not as a Jew, but as a, maybe also as a Jew, but as a sick German, or a sick soldier. I did not stay long with my unit because I felt that probably would be given guns and would have to fight the Russian army. I got myself again papers to travel from Tiraspol to Bucharest.
So it was still relatively easy for you to get papers?
I was running the whole show. I had all the papers. I was giving papers to others. So for me, it was a very simple thing to get the papers. And when I had the papers, as a matter of fact, I could have taken 50 papers with me because the officer in charge of the unit signed all the papers and gave them to me to fill them out for the other people, so I could do what I wanted. Nobody counted how many papers I got. I left Tiraspol in the train, went to Bucharest, and there I left the German army. I threw out the uniforms and became again a civilian.
When was this?
That was in, I'd say, probably in November 43. And November or December, I'm not quite.
Why did you decide to go to Bucharest?
Romania still had many Jews. There were conditions in Romania were completely different than in Russia, Russian-occupied territory. As I said before, I was concerned that I would be pressed into army service as a soldier with guns and to fight the Russian front, and I was not too eager to fight for the German army. So I thought it was the best bet to go to Bucharest and see what I can do there. Obviously, I did not want to appear as a Jew, and I started to ask questions where Poles are, and I was told certain place I could meet some Poles. I went as a Pole, as a Volksdeutscher from Jedzic to the Polish committee. They said I should go immediately to Krajowa, which was a place where the Polish headquarters was. I went to Krajowa probably in January, February, probably in January 1944, and the Poles did not ask many questions. There were also, by the way, many Polish Jews there. But based on my experience, I did not want to be a Jew. I lived as a Pole. I got some money, not very much, to survive. And for a few months, I was in Craiova. I think it was until June or July.
What did you do there?
Basically nothing. You sat around, you played cards, you went on walks, you were with other Poles. I mean, there was no danger, there was no fear, because the Germans were not there. The Romanians were there, and the Romanians treated the Poles basically well. So there was, we survived well, had absolutely no problems. It was a boring life, but I went to French, there was a French club, I went to the French club, I learned some English and so on, but it was not very much to do. In June one day, I wanted to come back to my room, which I had. On the way to my room, one of the poor said to me, "Don't go back, the Gestapo is in your room." I turned around and went into the forest. I told this Pole to, made some friends to tell my friends that I'm in the forest, they should come there. I do not know what the Gestapo wanted. Actually, it was a Geheime Feldpolizei, which is not Gestapo, it's the German army police. I don't know whether they wanted me as a deserter, I don't know whether they wanted me as a Jew, I don't know whether they wanted me as a Pole, but I was not going to find out. And I stayed in the forest, slept in the forest for 2 or 3 nights. My friends, the Poles, brought me food. Suddenly I was a hero because the Germans were looking for me. I was given money to go to Bucharest.
Who gave you money?
The Poles. Not very much, but just enough to survive. To go to Bucharest, I went, I mean, all I had was my shirt, my pants, and a pair of shoes I was wearing. I got to Bucharest, and I heard that three steamers are going to go to Israel with Jews. I decided to become a Jew, and I went to the Jewish community in Bucharest, and to try to convince them to put me in one of the steamers. It was much easier to become a member of the German army than to become a Jew again. Nobody wanted to believe me that I'm Jewish. They thought I'm sent there as a to cause some problems by the Germans. They weren't going to put me on the steamer. I remembered my father had some friends in Bucharest. I remember the name. I started to look for this person. I found the person. I told him who I was. I told him about my father. I told him stories which only the son of my father could tell. And he went with me to the Jewish community again and convinced them to put me in one of the boats. I got one of the boats and we went.
How did you feel when the Jewish committee wouldn't believe that you were Jewish after everything you'd been through?
I understood them. I couldn't blame them. Obviously, I was not happy, but I understood their feeling. I understood they were afraid. They weren't going to jeopardize life of 1,000 people because there was one, and that's basically was the story. And I got finally in one of the steamers. And
how did you feel when you succeeded and got on the steamer and you knew you were on the way to Palestine?
You know, words cannot express what you felt. You felt safe. Now, what does it mean to be safe? You know, it's you feel delirious, and then life returns to normal. I didn't get to Palestine without difficulties, because there were three steamers, and we were in the Black Sea, and one of the steamers, Bulbul, was torpedoed by German ships and was sunk in the Black Sea. And we could hear the cries of the survivors, and we had several survivors got onto our boat. The name of our boat was Mefkura. And then, as fate should want it, a terrible storm came, waves as tall as buildings. I didn't realize that water can be just as dangerous as the Germans. And terrible night where our people who were the captain of our boat, a Greek captain, gave up, couldn't do anything. Weather became normal. And we got to the Turkish shore where we left the boats, walked through Turkey, were put on trains, and went to Palestine by train from Turkey.
How long a journey was that, all in all?
You're asking me questions, it's difficult. I must have been over a week, but I don't, 6 days, I would not. The funny thing is I met a few years ago a woman who is married to a business friend of mine who was in the same steamer with me. We hadn't seen each other since 1944. When I came to Israel, all people from the steamer were put in the camp at Leet, which was the refugee camp, which the English army managed and run. Within a relatively short time, all the people were let out of the camp. I was the only one who was kept back because there were some rumors, German army. They thought that maybe I'm a German spy and so on. And I was interrogated several times, and finally, after being 30 days in the camp, they let me out.
How difficult were the interrogations?
They weren't difficult. I wasn't afraid of anything. I knew that I was Jewish. I knew it would take another day or another week and it would be out. It's after coming out of Poland, out of Russia, this was nothing. I played soccer with the English soldiers. They were very nice to me until they convinced themselves that I was Jewish, and I was just put out. Then I started my life in Israel, or in Palestine.
What was that like?
The beginning was very difficult. It's probably my son. Okay. The beginning was very difficult. You know, if you don't speak the language, if you don't have any money, if you really don't know what to do, I expected the world to provide me with a castle, servants, because I had survived. The world didn't. And obviously, I was very disappointed. The first money I earned is writing an article for one of the newspapers about my experiences. On the steamer, I had met some people. I became friendly with them. We decided to go to the Technion, and I went to the Technion with them. It was probably one of the more difficult times in my life. I had no money. I worked during the night as a night watchman and studied during the day in Technion. Not very easy. After 4 months, I gave up and I went to Tel Aviv and started working there, first as a laborer, then I got a job as in an office, and then I became a salesman in a paper company. And I stayed in Palestine until September, October 1947.
What about when the end of the war happened in Europe? How much did you...
45.
Yeah, in 45. How were you?
Remember I was in a bus when I heard that it's end of the war, and it was absolutely delirious. I mean, it was an end of an era, and it was something where I felt very good that I was able to survive and that I outsmarted the Germans.
Did you try to get in touch with your brother at that time?
My brother had gotten to Vienna, had advised an uncle of ours who was living in London. We had agreed that we would communicate with his uncle, and found out from my uncle, with this uncle, that my brother survived and is going to the United States. So I made also arrangements, got some papers from friends of mine, applied for a visa to the United States, and left for the United States in September, October 1947.
And when you got to the U.S.?
When I came here, the beginning was not easy. I had no money, I had no friends.
What sort of reception did you get when you arrived in the U.S.? How were you treated?
I had a one-man reception committee waiting for me. That was my brother. We went to the cousin here who had a small apartment, and my cousin, her husband, child, my brother, and I lived with her for 3-4 weeks. I remember it was in February or March. It was cold. My brother and I had only one winter coat together. So he wore it on Monday, I wore it on Tuesday. Monday he stayed home and I wore it, and vice versa. We were looking for jobs. My brother got a job as a messenger. I got a job as a glorified messenger first, and then I saw an ad in the paper and joined a company. It was about 45 years ago, where I'm still today.
What is the name of the company?
The name of the company is Centro Nacional Gottesman, and I'm senior executive vice president, and it's one of the largest pulp and paper companies in the world. And since 1948, I've had no complaints anymore.
Before you came to the U.S. From Palestine, did you go back home at all, or did you stay in Palestine before?
No, I did not. My home is not Vienna. My home is in New York. I traveled through Europe slowly. I wanted to see Italy. I had a little bit of money left. So I went through Italy, Vienna, France, England, where I had an aunt, and came to the United States.
Did you have nightmares about what you'd been through?
Nope.
When did you meet your wife?
I met my wife in 1953. Got married in 1954.
And she was not a survivor?
No, but since being married to me, she became a survivor.
And what has your life here been like?
Wonderful, because I had an interesting life. I have an interesting life. I was able to achieve financial independence. I have health, which is important, and I have traveled all over the world, mostly on business, partly on vacation. I've seen a great deal. I've met many interesting people, and I didn't imagine in Poland or Russia that life can be the way it has been for me in the United States.
You've told me earlier that you were in Munich with your son.
Yes, I went with my son to the Olympic Games in Munich and spent 2 weeks with him there.
What was that like?
When you refer to the Olympic Games, they're wonderful. When you refer what happened to the Israeli athletes, it's terrible. As a matter of fact, on the day this happened, Israeli athletes, I had arranged for my son and me to...
And what year was this?
1972, I think.
Okay.
I had arranged with my son to visit Dachau, which is a concentration camp in Germany.
How old was your son at that time?
12 and a half years old. For me, it was an emotional experience. My son was too young to understand what was happening in this camp 30 years earlier.
Did you talk about it much to your son, what you've gone through?
No, I don't think I've spoken much about my past to my son or to my wife. I don't think that people can understand what has happened to the survivors of the Holocaust unless you were involved yourself. As I said to you before, you don't know what hunger is unless you have been hungry. And you don't know what fear is unless you have lived in fear. it is not a subject which makes people very happy, and I have avoided talking about it except to the people who have gone through it. I have some friends who live in Israel who went through the same thing as I did. Yes, I can talk with them, but it's very difficult to talk with strangers about it, except about the adventure, you know, but not about the feelings and what really happened.
Is the existence of Israel very important to you?
I think it is important to every Jew. It gives a certain amount of security which was missing 50 years ago, and it would be very regrettable if Israel, for one reason or the other, would not survive.
What do you think, how are you able to come up with all those survival techniques to be so ingenious to keep going?
I don't think you come up with any techniques. I think it is a question of luck. I think it's a question of initiative. I think it's a question of wanting to survive, not giving in, fighting. My spirit was never broken. Some other people's spirit was broken, and they threw the towel in. I never did.
There was a movie made, Europa, Europa, that sort of was about someone's life who went through a similar experience, a Jew wound up joining the German army. What was that like, watching that movie for you?
Well, I could identify with the young man. It was partly also my story, and partly had the same problems. I understood him perfectly, and for me it was a remembrance of some of my adventures.
Why did you want to make this tape today?
I have never talked about my experiences. I was convinced by a friend of mine that I should leave something for people to listen to years to come. Maybe they will understand what has happened. Maybe they won't. I'm concerned that history should not repeat itself the way it happened to me. As a matter of fact, I didn't want to have any children when I came to the United States. I didn't want to have somebody else the same experiences as I had. As you see, I don't stick to all my principles. It is maybe somebody will learn or recognize something from my experience. That's why I made the tape.
Thank you.
Today is June 1st, 1995. Survivor Leo Schenker, interviewer Sherry Mattenstein.
Leo, would you like to introduce these lovely people, starting with this woman sitting right next to you?
This woman sitting right next to me is, what's her name? Olivia Schenker, my wife for 40 years. As a matter of fact, I tell a story that we married 80 years, she 40 years, and I 40 years. Next to Olivia is Carolyn, my daughter-in-law. Curtis is next to Carolyn. He's my son. And Allie is their baby, our only granddaughter. Hi, Allie.
I'll start with you, Olivia. You're not a survivor, but your husband said before, in a way, it's almost like you are, from having
been married to him and listened to his stories for so long. Why did you want him to make this tape today to talk about his memories?
Well, actually, I think it's probably very valuable for future, but I had nothing to do with his doing it. I simply heard he was going to do it, and I think it was a good idea.
What's it been like for you living with someone who went through everything that he went through?
Well, it's possible that the type of life I led was a little bit different, because a person that's gone through as much as Leo has is much more enclosed, a very closed person, very unable in many instances to give forth of himself emotionally, because I guess the emotional repressions that he might have had during that time. So that I think that may have been one of the differences, and I'm the one that's more outgoing and he's really very not so outgoing.
Is there anything that you want to say to him right now?
Anything I want to say to him right now? That well, we've had 40
camera.
Years, it worked out. We'll hope we'll have another few. So therefore, I think that in a way he was lucky that I was brought up in such a way that I was able to take it like an online page. In other words, I accepted him the way he was and didn't try to make any changes.
Carolyn?
Mm-hmm. Something to say?
I know you're a little new to the family, but
well, we've been married almost 5 years.
Oh, okay. Well, how did you feel when you heard about all the experiences that your father-in-law went through?
You know, I didn't hear about it right away. People in the family don't actually talk about it that much, but slowly I started to hear the story, and you know, I was shocked and amazed at what, you know, he had been through. I was shocked. I had seen movies about the Holocaust, but I really had never known anyone who had lived through as much as he's lived through. And I'm very glad that he's doing this film, because without things like this, I think people would start to forget. It'll be written in books, but to hear somebody say it is a lot different than reading it. So.
And this is sort of a legacy for your daughter to be able to.
And we'll always tell her about what happened so that she can always, you know what a special man he is, and he's really, I mean, a survivor in the true sense of the word, what he went through to be here. So.
And Curtis?
Well, I think for me it's very tough to relate to, because as much as I can hear about it, as much as I can watch movies about it, it just, unless you're there and you experience it, I just don't think you can understand it. So when you hear real life actual stories, and when you hear the person, my father, tell me the stories, I can have a visceral reaction to it, but it's impossible for me to understand the emotion behind what happened, because I wasn't there. And I think unless you were there, you can't really understand it. At least that's the impression that I've gotten. I think in the same sense, though, what happened to a great extent has molded my father, and I know that when I was growing up, or when I would have certain dilemmas in my life, he never really viewed them as that pertinent, not pertinent is the wrong word, that absolutely monumental at the moment, because I guess when you compare it to what he'd been through, they all kind of take a step back to that. So that it was kind of very good in terms of putting things in perspective when I would, you know, break my toenail or fall in a basketball game or, you know, get a C as opposed to a B. It was, you know, all in relative perspective. And I think that once you go through something like that, you can kind of take a step back and have a perspective in any other problems that you might have in life, and kind of say, well, relative to what I went through, and I've survived this, I'll get through the next thing. And a lot, I think of what the way my father views his life is that I survived this, which I'm not sure I was supposed to survive, so now every day is a new day, and whatever I face, I'm not going to worry about it, and just whatever happens from here happens, and I'm just not going to worry about it, because if I can't control it, I'm not going to worry about it. And that's how I think he leads his life.
Your father talked about when you went to Munich, and mm-hmm. you were young then, but mm-hmm. what was it like for you seeing Dachau and what happened at the Olympic game there?
You know, again, I think that when I went there, the most I got was more out of watching my father's face when he was looking at Dachau, more than actually understanding Dachau, because I was 13, and it was very ironic that while we were there, Israeli athletes got kidnapped and then killed, because that had obviously a much more present and moving feeling for me than seeing Dachau, which again were pictures to me, and it was just very difficult to understand what had gone on there. But seeing the Mark Spitz news conference where he was talking about the Israeli athletes and how they were killed, that was much more jarring to me, because it was something that had a direct correlation to what had happened 30 years ago.
Anything else anybody wants to say?
I think I'm the only one who wants to say something.
You're the most talkative here.
I think I have been very lucky in Europe to survive. I think I have been very lucky in the United States to have a family as I have it, including Allie. And I don't know whether it's luck, I don't know whether it's somebody above me, but say the last 50 years of my life have been pretty blessed with luck and satisfaction and with a great family.
Okay, thank you everyone.
Have a good time,
have
a good time.
Thank you.
Okay.
She's ready to get up. That's it. We've had it.
Cut. You were good, sweetheart.
She was so good.
She was fine.
She was so quiet.
Yes.
Yeah, you were good.
The first picture is the wedding picture of my parents. On the left side is my father, Joseph Pinkas. On the right side is my mother, Rebecca, called Riva. They were married late 1920. They were married in Vienna. I don't remember the exact date. These are three pictures from Vienna. The one on the left side top is on the right side my mother, on the left side my brother Kurt, on the lower center my brother Henry, and upper center is my picture. The next picture below the one I just described is my brother Kurt and I. I would assume that's somewhere late 1920. And the third picture is my father in the center, my brother Kurt in the left, and myself on the right.
Do you remember anything about any details about when any of these photos were taken, any of the circumstances?
No, I do not, but from when I look at them, they were all taken late 1920s. But this picture here is my brother. Yeah, none of them. This is a photograph For me, taken early 1930, I think it was for some document. These three photographs are from my brother Kurt. I mentioned earlier that he was with the German radio station Wehrmachtsender Krim, and that during the retreat I lost trace of him in Kherson. When I checked after the war with the Germans who served in the same radio station, I was told that Kurt had a nervous breakdown and they don't believe that he survived the further retreat from Kherson.
When you checked with them, did you tell them the story that he was Jewish?
No, I did not tell them the whole story. I just told the name, and I asked them. It was right after the war, and I don't think, I wasn't sure that they would have helped if they would have known that he was Jewish. By the way, my brother Kurt was without any doubt the most talented from the three of us. He was excellent painter, he was an excellent student, and he was an excellent sport athlete. It just shows you that the best don't always survive. This picture is of my brother Henry and of myself. Henry is the youngest. As I mentioned earlier, he was the one who left us, went to Krakow, and then joined us under very unpleasant circumstances for him in Simferopol. This is a photograph of mine, our wedding, my wife Livia and myself, December 19th, 1954.
Where were you married?
We were right in the Sherry Netherland Hotel in New York. This is a photograph from a party before the Beatles or other people were popular. On the left side is Sue Topher. I'm next to her. Next to me is my wife Livia. And far right is a friend of ours. It must have been taken about 30 years ago, 25 to 30 years ago.
And you cut your hair since then?
Somewhat. Here's a picture taken during our celebration for our 35th wedding anniversary. The party was at the Union League Club in New York. This is a wedding picture of my daughter-in-law Carolyn, my son Curtis. On the left you have my wife Livia, then Curtis and Carolyn. On the lower right is my late mother-in-law Olga, and the upper right is my picture. The wedding took place on September 8th, 1990. In the Pier Hotel in New York. This is a picture taken during our 40th wedding anniversary celebration, which took place also in the Union League Club. This is a picture of the newest addition to the Schenker family, Alexandra Olga, which I'm holding in my hands. She was born January 17, 1995. For my 70th birthday, friends of mine published a newspaper. It was printed in Buenos Aires. That's why it is called the Buenos Aires Herald. And the paper has articles from friends of mine from all over the world. I had no idea that this paper was being published, and I was very touched when I received it.
Why was it in Buenos Aires?
Because the idea for the paper came from my friends in Buenos Aires. They collected all the articles. They had it printed, and they brought it to New York when they came to my anniversary party.